You're watching the best of ESC.
In SERVE HF, 1,325 systolic heart failure patients presenting central sleep apnea were randomized to receive either adaptive servo ventilation or medical management alone. Median follow-up was 31 months.
We found actually there was no difference in outcome at all. And surprisingly, which has taken both respiratory physicians and cardiologists completely by surprise, we found an increase in mortality. And if you look at cardiovascular mortality, it was up 34%. So not only does it not make any difference to the patients with systolic heart failure, it actually increases the risk of them dying. So this is a real game changer trial, really important.
Printing is entering the area of valvular imaging and repair, as illustrated by the first 3D printed tricuspid using transthoracic echocardiography.
We hope that it will facilitate the communication with the surgeons, with relatives, and it also will hopefully provide us with more insights on the tricuspid valve pathologies. And the hope is that after advancing our understanding, we'll also be able to project much easier the future percutaneous intervention dedicated for a tricuspid valve that now are emerging in the field.
A leadless single pacing pacemaker has been evaluated in the Leadless 2 study, a non-randomized trial in which 300 patients from 56 North American centers has the device transfemorally implanted in the right ventricle. Vivek Reddy summarizes the key findings 6 months after implantation.
Number one, the device can be implanted in 96% of the patients. Number two, there's about a 6.5% rate of major complications, and we expect this to decrease over time. We have to remember that 99% of the operators had never performed a device implantation before. Number three, the vast majority of patients, once the device is successfully implanted, has adequate sensing and pacing over the long term. And number four, the expected longevity of this device is out to 15 plus years.
MENTREPATH study is a randomized comparison of catheter ablation and antiarrhythmic drug therapy as first-line treatment for paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, and 5 years follow-up results were reported in London.
After 5 years, there was a significantly lower burden of atrial fibrillation in the catheter ablation group than in the drug therapy group. Significantly more patients were free from any and symptomatic atrial fibrillation in the catheter ablation group than in the drug group, and only 3% in the ablation group and 5% in the drug group had developed persistent atrial fibrillation. That's very few. 2 years, the patient's quality of life score was significantly better than at baseline in both treatment groups, and with no difference between groups. And now, after 5 years, still quality of life is significantly better than at baseline, with both treatments and without any difference from 2 years.
Well, John, were you surprised by the results of SERVE-HF? How can you explain this increase in mortality?
Okay, well, the first question is the easy one to answer. Yes, I was very surprised, as I think everybody was. As you know, this was a trial of a certain type of assisted ventilation in central sleep apnea, and there was a 30% increase in mortality. Can I explain it? Very difficult. There are lots of theories. Some people believe, for example, the hemodynamic effects of this ventilation could be detrimental in patients with severe heart failure. That's a possibility. But there's a very interesting counter theory, which is actually central sleep apnea may be a protective adaption in heart failure, and that by countermanding the, that, you make patients worse. Now, I think we'll be able to tease this out in heart failure because there's another type of treatment for central sleep apnea, which is phrenic nerve stimulation. That's being studied at the moment. That has no hemodynamic effect. So it will sort of tease out whether this was a harmful effect of the ventilation or whether it was a harmful effect of actually affecting the central nervous system abnormality. I think the messages for physicians here are that you shouldn't use assisted non-invasive ventilation in patients with central sleep apnea, but it's still got a very important role to play in the relief of obstructive sleep apnea. And of course, we all use CPAP and other forms of assisted ventilation in our patients with acute heart failure, where we know it's safe from a large trial called 3CPO and is effective in relieving symptoms.
It comes up with a new topic also. We have been aware and we have concerns about drugs which are lowering in our patients with heart failure, yes, and diabetes, the, yes, glucose level.
Yes.
So did we get any new information from the studies being presented at the ESC Congress this year?
You're absolutely right. We were very concerned last year following the SAVOR-TIMI 53 results showing that a DPP-4 inhibitor might increase the risk of heart failure because, of course, heart failure is the most diabetogenic state that there is, and anywhere between 30 and 50% of patients with heart failure have diagnosed and undiagnosed diabetes, and we need new treatments. And this looked like a promising type of glucose-lowering therapy, but then there was this safety concern. At this meeting, I think those safety concerns were put to rest because a much larger trial called TECOS showed that another DPP-4 inhibitor actually did not increase the risk of heart failure. And there was an additional study with a different type of incretin-based therapy, a GLP-1 analog, a trial called ELIXA in acute MI patients, also did not show any concern about increased risk of heart failure. So I think those concerns have been put to rest.
Do you want to make any additional comments on this, Sanjay?
Well, I do, yes. I mean, it was a non-inferior trial, but we should still be punching our arms in the air about this because the situation is that although glycemic control has a very modest effect on the actual heart, it's got a very significant effect on microvascular complications, notably retinopathy and nephropathy. And of course, blindness due to diabetes is the commonest cause of blindness in the Western world. And so in this particular situation, normally people with heart failure, they've only got insulin or metformin, but only in a very small number of cases because many of these people have also got impaired creatinine clearance and therefore metformin is prohibited. So I think the fact that we can now use another oral hypoglycemic agent to prevent microvascular complications is a very big deal.
Great. Let's move on to another topic because we had this fantastic new 3D printing of a tricuspid valve. First of all, do we really need it?
Well, that will come probably in the future if we really need it. There are already some experience, for example, with congenital heart disease using CT or CMR that have much higher spatial resolution to create models where the surgeons can decide and tailor which is the best approach for each patient. And this is for the first time from transthoracic echocardiography, 3D transthoracic echocardiography, getting the model of the tricuspid valve. Really needed, we don't know. There is the growing field of transcatheter interventions where we don't see the structure directly as a difference from the surgeons and where we need really a detailed anatomical evaluation of the patients. The tricuspid valve is a sort of the forgotten valve sometimes, and we have this growing population that have been operated in the past from the left side, from the mitral valve or the aortic valve, that come back again with tricuspid regurgitation, and they have a very high risk for surgery, and they may be admitted recurrently because of heart failure. And now there are evolving new techniques on transcatheter tricuspid repair, where this technology of 3D printing maybe can help us to tailor the treatment of the patient.
Do you think that it might also apply to the other valves, such as the mitral valve, because it may help in discussing with the surgeon having such a tool?
Yeah, there are already some experiences on the communication between the surgeons and the cardiologists, how to treat the patients, for example, with mitral valve, with 3D transesophageal echocardiography. That technique already gives us a very good information, anatomical information of the mitral valve. But if in addition to that, you can print it, you can have it in your hands, or you can even imagine that you can print similar tissue characteristics of the mitral valve. You can see what happens if you apply certain ring or if you apply certain techniques of plication. So you can, for each patient, personalize the treatment that you want.
Excellent.
So we saw some interesting information at this Congress about leadless pacing. And Cecilia, my question to you, leadless, but perhaps needless.
Good start. Well, as a pacemaker doctor, I would like to get rid of leads and the pacemaker pocket because they're related to complications. Now we have hopes for the future, I would say, because there are now two types of leadless pacemaker that are being studied in observational trials. And this is one such, leadless two, in which 300 patients who were indicated for a VVI device, a very unusual indication in cardiac pacing, they were implanted with a 4 centimeter, 5 millimeter width device into the right ventricle, and they achieved their goals. They had a high successful implantation rate. In inexperienced implanter who had no previous experience of leadless implantations, they had good pacemaker function. But there were some complications, and that is, in my opinion, related to the 18 French introductory sheet that is involved in the placement of this device, and which may potentially also damage the tricuspid valve, I don't know. But they reported the complication rate, which they said was comparable to pacemaker registry. If you go to the Danish pacemaker registry, which is ongoing, the complications that were serious, such as cardiac perforation and tamponade, are actually higher in this study than reported in this registry. So it's not free from complications.
So an innovation that's on the way, but not quite ready yet.
Yeah, I think
and,
that's
you know,
way.
The place for single chamber pacing these days is maybe quite limited.
I would say about 10%.
About 10%. Okay, now there's also been interesting data on the follow-up of AF ablation. And the impact. Tell us about that.
Yes, I think most of us, when we consider RF ablation in an atrial fibrillation patients, we go for trying a drug first, an antiarrhythmic drugs, and that goes pretty much with the guidelines. But the MANTRA PAF trial was interesting in that this challenged this approach and tried RF ablation versus antiarrhythmic drug as a first-line therapy. And what they showed over the 5 years is that 15% more patients in the RF ablation group were free for any atrial fibrillation, and 10% more were free from symptom-related atrial fibrillation compared to antiarrhythmic drugs arm. So I believe it really emphasizes that we should perhaps consider RF ablation a little bit earlier than we are currently.